started right away, and I'll start by saying good evening and thanks to you for coming, for so many of you for coming. My name is Maggie Carney, and I am president of the Duxbury Beach Reservation. And we are here tonight because we are making plans to strengthen the beach against rising sea level and the accompanying severe storms that are assaulting this fragile barrier. Last year, the reservation partnered with the town of Duxbury to apply for a grant from Massachusetts Department of Coastal Zone Management, better known as CZM, so we could have some scientific research behind our plans. We received a grant last spring and were able to hire the Woods Hole Group, an internationally recognized coastal engineering consulting firm, to perform a coastal processes study of Duxbury Beach. I have asked Andre Martichini, a trustee of the reservation and a member of the reservation's technical committee, to introduce our distinguished guests and this evening's speaker from the Woods Hole Group. Andre will begin with a very brief update on the road work that is currently in progress and related to these efforts. Please note that the presentation is being taped and recorded by PAC-TV. Andre.
Thank you, Maggie. So first of all, thank you all for coming out here tonight. I think this is going to be a very interesting presentation. And before we go, we just wanted to give you a little update on some of the projects. Many of you go out to the beach, you've seen all the construction going on, you're probably wondering, what the heck are we doing out there? So we've had a couple of big projects, and I just wanted to kind of point them out. The first one was a project that we did here, the cobble berm restoration, where we had about 2,090 feet of cobble berm, which was an area on the bay side, which was actually eroding away. We got a grant from CZM. And by the way, I'd like to introduce Jason Bertner. Jason, raise your hand. So for people who want to talk to CZM about issues, Jason's our guy. We wouldn't have been able to do a lot of these projects without CZM's help. So anyway, so I'll show you a picture, but we restored a part of that, which was basically eroding away the roadway. The next project that we worked on was about 8,400 feet of roadway where we started to raise it. And basically it's from the bridge going south, basically to about High Pines, where it makes the curve as you get to High Pines. And we've raised the road about 18 inches. We're trying to eventually get all of the road all the way down in here, and we have a bunch of low areas that flood today. So we're trying to do that, but this was the first part. That's the part that's most heavily traveled by people. So we're trying to get those pieces of our infrastructure up to speed. And the last project up on very top there is a road raising project and repaving that's going on out at from Blakeman's, the pavilion, north to the north part where the homes began. So one more. So on this project, this is what's going on. If you go out there today, it's a mess. And what we're doing is, this is Blakeman's over here, and these homes here is where our property, the reservation's property, end. And so the first phase of the project is being done now in the spring, and will be done by April 30th before the plovers arrive. And we're repaving this section of road, and then as we get next fall, once the summer crowds are done, we're going to be repaving the road from here, as well as repaving the parking lot and regrading the gravel overflow lot that's there. Next. Now, if you look at this area today, this is looking north. This road is hazardous to your health. It is full of potholes, and if you look, this was, I believe, on February 3rd. What happens is we're getting a lot of flooding. So people who talk about sea level rise not happening, it is happening. We are experiencing the flood levels are coming up. And because of that, it's contributing to the pothole erosion. So we're raising the road and everything here about 18 inches. So the first phase is actually beyond where the trees are. And unfortunately, we couldn't get this done before the plovers came. This is just a picture of the cobble berm project. So before we did the work, you can see that there was a lot of erosion to the edge of the road, the posts, and we were literally getting ready to lose the road. And we didn't want that to happen. So through our CZM grant, we've been able to restore the cobble berm and stabilize that area. So Kirk Bosma, who's going to be talking to us tonight, is going to be talking a little bit of some of the reasons why we're seeing some of these problems. And last but not least, the reservation is very worried. We do a lot of grass planting, as many of you, I'm sure, come out and help with grass planting. Grass is actually getting to be a scarce commodity. A lot of people up and down the coast, especially after Hurricane Sandy, grass is becoming scarce. So as part of the CZM grant, we've made our own nurseries, two of them, one in Kingston Conservation Land, and two in Silver Lake High School. So we're trying to grow our own grass so that we can be self-sustaining. So this is a project that just got done last year. We're about to harvest our first, this fall, we'll be harvesting our first grass for planting this fall. So with that, what I'd like to do is Kirk Bosma from Woods Hole Group is a coastal engineer who's been, I've been working with Kirk for a long time now in a lot of different projects. Woods Hole Group is great at doing these kind of modeling. So what we're trying to understand here, as we look forward for the long-term planning of Duxbury Beach, we need to understand the science. One, so that we can get grant money, because as you know, the reservation is a nonprofit, and we rely on, you know, very limited funding. And the projects, by the way, the projects that I just described, the project that's undergoing right now is a $750,000 project. The cobble berm, I think, was $86,000, and the other road project was like $250,000. So these are very expensive projects. And as we go forward and look long-term on the rest of the beach, we're talking millions of dollars of potential long-term capital projects. So, Kirk, why don't you take it away? This is going to be an interesting presentation with a little bit of science. So hopefully it's not too complicated, but I think it'll be very fascinating. Kirk?
Thank you, Andre. Thank you for that warm introduction. Typically, I don't like you to clap until the end because you might not like what we're going to talk about. So
we're clapping for Andre.
Or clap for Andre, right? Well, I don't know if that was a good idea either. So a couple things. We're really talking about maybe two aspects here of the Duxbury Beach system. First thing, as you can see in the title of the slide, is we're going to be focusing on the coastal processes. And what that means is, what is going on out there, right? What are the waves doing? What are the currents doing? What are tides doing? How is this beach being shaped? Not only today, but also as we kind of start to look forward into the future, right? Climate change, as Andre mentioned, is a real thing. It's happening. You know, whether or not you want to believe some of the projections that go really high or not, that's not so important. But you should know that, you know, over the last 100 years or so, the water level is going up. It's going up about 2.8 millimeters per year. In the last more recent time frame, the last 20 years or so, it's actually going up 4 millimeters per year. And that's just measured data. That's fact. That isn't any projections by scientists or anything like that. So we're dealing with some realities here. So we'll talk a little bit about the coastal processes, but then we'll also focus on resiliency. Okay? Why are we worried about resiliency? Right? Well, you know, it's a nice beach system for starters, right? For recreational purposes and things like that. But if you look behind Duxbury Bay, you're going to see a lot of infrastructure, right? So if that barrier beach and system isn't there, Sakewich Head, Granite Point, and so on and so forth, waves, currents, storms, hurricanes, nor'easters now have more direct access to the infrastructure. right? So it's a natural barrier that's there that serves a very important protective purpose. So it's not just about recreation, it's not just about birds, it's also about protection of the community, the infrastructure, and important assets, okay? Unfortunately, I do not have a clicker to advance the slide, so I'm gonna be bouncing around a little bit back and forth, but that's okay. Or Andre might do it for me. All right, so you're gonna have to skip ahead past your update slides. What you wanna do is use this down arrow right here, okay? All right, so as was mentioned, this is all work done through a CZM grant. Just a little plug for CZM, these grants are great for communities. There's a lot of them going on. They're very beneficial for understanding vulnerabilities, both to climate change, but just in general, to beach systems, to coastal systems. And they're very focused on looking at options besides just putting up hard infrastructure everywhere, seawalls, revetments, right? Really focused on some green approaches to how we can make things better. So I really support this grant program that's happening. We have six primary tasks that we're looking at here, and we'll go through some of them. We're not complete with this whole project yet, but I thought it was a good time, Maggie thought it was a good time to start giving you an update on what's going on, because we really want to involve the community in this process and some of the thinking that's going on. So the first task really looks at data collection, okay? So that's tides, currents, waves, what's the grain size, what's happened historically out there. There's a boatload, pardon the pun, of information that already has been collected out at Duxbury Beach, and we're supplementing that with some more data that is relevant. Task 2, 3, and 4 really get into some of the coastal processes aspects. So we're really looking at numerical modeling of what the waves are doing, what the hydrodynamics are doing. What hydrodynamics are is the movement of water in and out of Duxbury Bay, so looking at the backside of the barrier beach. And then sand, how's sand moving? What's the sediment transport patterns like? And so these are done for existing conditions, meaning what's going on out there now. And then that ties back into task 5, which is we're going to be looking at some kind of restoration alternatives. Those can then be plugged back into these models to see kind of how they work, how they perform, where you're going to get the most cost benefit in some of your resiliency adaptations, some of your projects, right? So Andre just mentioned these things aren't cheap, but they cost money. So if you're going to go spend it, you want to have at least some level of confidence that these things are going to prove to serve some benefit in some positive returns. And so that's where this modeling really comes in. You don't have to believe everything in the model, but they do serve a pretty good purpose for looking at those alternatives. Okay, next slide. What are some of the goals of the grant? You know, we want to improve our understanding, right? It's complicated. Waves, currents, they all interact with each other. But if we can understand a little bit better what's going on out on our beach, maybe we can have a better chance of making it more resilient over the long term. We need to find a technical basis, right? That was already mentioned. If we're going out and doing projects, we want to have the technical backing to go forth and say, yeah, this is going to have a good chance of working. It doesn't mean it's going to, you know, stop Sandy from coming, but hey, it's going to give us some resiliency. So we're advancing our understanding. We want to develop some potential restoration and resiliency alternatives out on the beach. And that includes two aspects. It includes kind of barrier beach-wide. What can we do barrier beach-wide? But the reservation also has identified site-specific locations that are problematic. And so you can start to have projects that are more bite-sized, that serve good and are more attainable in the near term, right? So they're not, you know, massive multi-million dollar projects. We can get some good projects going forward. And then, you know, we're doing a little bit this tonight, public outreach and dissemination. All right, so that first task, let's talk a little bit about the data that we collected out there. It was primarily collected last summer. We do have a number of existing data sources out there. There's great topographic information about the beach. There's been a number of surveys out there. There's LIDAR flight information on the elevations. There's plenty of bathymetric data offshore, basically the elevations under the water. And we have some buoy data from NOAA. We have historical aerial photography out there. So all that existing data was available, and we're utilizing all that, okay? We're also collecting a bunch of new data out there, and that's shown on the map over there. We have CTD stations, that's measuring conductivity or the salinity of the water, the temperature, and the depth or the tide, essentially. We put in this as part of the program. We deployed it as a kind of a bonus. We didn't actually charge you for this. Was a tilt current meter, and that's at this location right here, which is generally in the vicinity of that cobble berm project, right? So we wanted to look at the, if some of you know, the navigational channel runs right up against the backside of that barrier beach, right? So what's going on there? And we put in a current meter to look at that. And then we had a near shore wave station. So right off the beach, we're measuring what the waves are doing in currents offshore. And then we did some sediment samples. Next slide. So here's, hit the down arrow one more time. So here was the one of the tide stations. This is at the Harbor Master location. This is what the instrument looks like. It was deployed right off the pier here, and it's basically measuring the salinity, the water surface elevation, and the temperature at that particular location, right? Next slide. Here's another site. This is in the upper marsh, hit the down arrow one more time. You can see it identified by the yellow circle there. So this was right in the bottom of the marsh. Right, so we're basically looking at what's happening as you go from offshore into Duxbury Bay. We had another system at Clark's Island, and then up into the system. Okay, next slide. This is the basic results. Here are the three time series of the water surface elevation. So this is the tide going up and down. This is an NAVD 88 feet. Here's a snippet of time that we took from June to through the start of July. The red signal is the water surface elevation fluctuation in the upper marsh, okay? This is what's happened. The blue is at the Harbor Master location. So you may say, well, why is it cutting off here? Well, it's drying out, right? The marsh dries at low tide. The elevation of the marsh is above the low tide elevation. So that particular channel that you just saw was basically drying out at low tide. So we can then see how the changes in water surface elevation work throughout the system. Here's kind of a closer zoom at what's happening there. Again, you can see there's fairly little attenuation between Clark's Island and Harbor Master, meaning the tide is basically the same. There's a little bit of a delay or a lag due to the friction in the system at low tide, and you can see how the marsh area works there. Salinity. We're not really focused too much on salinity in terms of resiliency, but we collected the data anyways for future potential projects, future modeling efforts. If we ever want to look at water quality in Duxbury Bay or other things, we can start to look at the salinity as well. The red, again, is the upper marsh gauge. The blue is Harbor Master. And then Clark's Island, which is very consistent, right? About 30 PSU salinity throughout the entire time frame. You'll see drop-offs in both the Harbor Master and Upper Marsh. Does anybody know what that is? It's like school, it's questions.
Rain.
Rain, right, rainfall. So you get a big rainfall event. I didn't plot it out here, but it happens around June. All of a sudden you got runoff coming off the marsh, and it becomes really fresh, right? You also have that happening in unique, I think there's some outfalls near the Harbor Master location that influences that salinity signal as well. Next slide. Okay, so that was tides. And you say, well, why did you collect those? Well, when we get to the hydrodynamic model, you'll start to see why I needed that information, right? I want to make sure the model is simulating what we see kind of in reality out there in the system. Okay, down one more arrow. This is the location of a tilt current meter. This is what the tilt current meter looks like in the laboratory when we're setting it up. Again, what we're really focused on here is this navigational channel that exists here. Initially, when we look at this system, it's not ideal that it's kind of hugging that barrier beach. If you talk about resiliency and erosion, there's a reason why you need a cobble berm at that location on the backside of the beach. Next slide. Here's what it looks like in action. So the way this thing works is kind of interesting. It tilts in the current, and just like your smartphone when you flip it knows what direction it's going. It's the same theory here, and so it's measuring the currents that go by. And we measured from, again, June to the end of July, so a little bit longer time period, looking at kind of the changes in velocity and direction that occur in that particular location. something popped out right away. There's a very unique signature of currents that occur between a spring tide setting and a neap tide setting, right? So during spring side, not surprising yet, during a spring current, you get 80 centimeters per second, so you get pretty fast movement. Neap, it's about half that, 20 to 40. Next slide. But if you really start to break down the data, and I know this curve is a little hard to see, this is the tide or the water surface elevation going up and down at that location. And then here you're going to see the current speed, right? So as water's flooding into the system, the current picks up, right? Water's coming in on a flood tide. Speed comes up, gets near high tide. It's draining out. It's draining out slower, right? Comes in again, picks up current. That basically is an indication of a flood-dominant system, meaning your floods are stronger than your water coming out. That's going to mean sand is going to move into the system. And it's not super strong current, but it is a flood-dominant system, and that's what happens during neap tides. Okay, next slide. But if you go to spring tides, you have almost a transition to a different regime in this particular location. And so you have very, very strong currents at low tide during an ebb and during the flood. Why? Because your water gets so shallow there. The tide drops a lot lower, and that water is basically shooting through a hose. Like if you have an attachment at the end of the fire hose and you squeeze it, right, it's going through a smaller volume. That's what's happening in that channel. And you get very, very swift currents, 80 centimeters per second there during that low tide. Now, at high tide, you have deeper water, so you get a lot less current in there, okay? Now, all that changes when you have a storm, but that was a unique finding at that location. Waves, we also collected wave information. This is what the wave gauge looks like. It's acoustic, so it basically sits at the bottom in this trawl-resistant mount and measures the particles in the water and the waves at the surface and gives us information on what the waves are doing. We did a 60-day deployment. It was in about 38 feet of water. Go down, and it was right at that location there. Why did we put it here, right, as opposed to out here? Well, all these little points up there is where we have data already, right? So what we really needed was information right at the beach, and that's why we put it there, okay, near shore, what the waves are doing. So now we have a better understanding of what happens when waves go from way offshore to our site of interest. Next slide. These are a little hard to see. These are just some of the results from the waves. It gives us waves, it gives us currents, it gives us directions, a lot of information. The one unfortunate thing about this whole thing was, it's summer, right? So not a lot of wave energy out there, right? We would have loved to put it out in the winter, see bigger events. Keep going down, Andre. So here you can see there's a pretty big event, waves getting up 1.5 meters, you know, 4 feet or so, 5 feet around the beginning of June. Keep going. Really quiet at the early onset of June. One more. Nothing. And then there's a, you know, 6 to 7 foot wave event. Again, this is pretty close to the beach at the very end of June. So not ideal, but it's enough information for us to start understanding what happens to waves when they go from onshore or offshore to onshore. Okay, next slide. These are those two big events I just mentioned on June 1 and June 28. I don't want people to have to understand what all this is, but this is stuff we use in terms of the spectral distribution, meaning how the waves approach the shoreline, okay? It's a frequency distribution, meaning how the waves, periods, how quickly they come in, what the energy distribution is that they approach the shoreline, okay? So we do have some energy there. Grain size, we looked at the grain size information along the beach at 10 different locations, both on kind of the front side of the barrier and the back side of the barrier. It's mostly sand, some more fine sand up to the north, and then as you head down, you start to get a little bit coarser in some areas. Not surprising. Okay, so we have all that information that we can start to plug into some of these models. But before we did that, we wanted to look at kind of historically what has happened out at Duxbury Beach and the Barrier Beach. And to do that, we looked at a whole litany of historical photographs, aerials, maps, to basically quantify changes to the shoreline. Okay, we're really looking at how the shoreline eroded and grew through time. These were the dates we selected. We actually had probably 20 more, but these are the best resolution and covered the most area of Duxbury Beach. Next slide. Here's what that looks like. Now, CZM has maps similar to this that they do on shoreline change. We did our own analysis with our own aerials and kind of updated that with a little bit higher resolution. And so these are just a couple of examples of the area kind of on the northern part of the beach. What you're looking at here is every one of these little white, every white line is an area where we measured a transect or a rate of erosion. These numbers here correspond to how many feet per year you're losing at that location. So up here it was 2.4 feet per year, here 2.3, 1.8, okay? We looked on the back side as well to basically quantify how the shoreline is changing, okay? Important, we had, as you saw from that previous slide, data from 1853 to 2015, okay? So we looked at the change over that whole time period, but we also looked at two distinctly different time periods. We looked at kind of a historical time period from 1853 to 1971. We also looked at a contemporary time period from 1996 to 2015. Why did we do that? Okay. Because right about this time between 71 and 96, people started getting active. Active in trying to maintain the beach, putting dunes in, raising roads, doing things to protect and influence the system. So this gives us an idea of what that influence of people has had on the beach and some of the trends in shoreline change. Next slide. Here's just another example of kind of the southern component of the shoreline change analysis. And again, there's two figures here because this is covering the whole time frame from 1853 to 2015, and this is more recent. So for example, one thing to point out real quick here, you know, at transect 156, you see over the long term, right, this is actually very stable, about a tenth of a foot of change. So basically no change over the long term. But if you look in more contemporary time frame between 96 and 2015, it's going at a foot per year, right? So erosion is accelerating at that location. Okay, next slide. All right, so this breaks that down a little bit further, all right? And this is relatively easy to understand once I explain what these are. So you're looking at three lines. The legend up there, and this is the south. This is the front side of the barrier beach. So here's High Pines. Here's the Duxbury Beach Reservation parking lot where all the work is going on right now. And so this is the north down to the south. So you're walking down the beach from north to south, okay? The green line, I'm sorry, let me start with the broken kind of purple line is the long-term trend. So that's 1853 to present, right? Pretty consistent eroding about a foot to 2 feet per year, right? Down that whole front side of the beach, it's eroding. It's basically overwashing, right? It's eroding on the front, it's kind of overwashing to the back, and it's kind of migrating landward. The green line is kind of pre-human influence. So that's between 1853 to 1971. And you can see the erosion rate was much higher, kind of in part of the parking lot area, okay? That's probably a pretty natural trend due to some of the waves and currents that exist out there. It was much lower as you had headed down to the south, about a foot per year, up to almost 4 feet per year in this location. The blue dashed broken line from 96 to 2015, the more recent contemporary, shows a very different trend, right? If you look down here in the north, it's zero change, almost a little growth in some areas, and then a big reduction in that shoreline change rate. Everybody already knows the answer to that. I don't have to say it, right? People started doing dunes. They started doing protection, taking action, and it's reduced the erosion rate in that area, okay? Meanwhile, the erosion has continued due to increased sea level rise, more energetic events. We see a heightened erosion as we head down towards the south. Next slide. similar. This is now on the back side of the barrier beach, right? So here's the High Pines area, the Powder Point Bridge again on the back side. So this would be north to south again, looking on the back side of the beach. Same three lines. Much smaller change overall, right? It's not facing the open waves of the ocean, but it's, you know, and it's still eroding. There's some growth, there's some erosion. These blocked areas right here are areas where there's essentially marsh. That makes it really kind of tricky to identify what's happening with the shoreline because there's a marsh in front of it doing a whole bunch of stuff. So these really wild variations in here are basically likely loss of marsh material or growth of marsh. And in the older time periods, there's probably some growth. More recently, we've had some loss of marsh in the High Pines region. Probably familiar with that. Okay, next slide. Again, this is now looking at that south shoreline. And that was that area I was kind of pointing out near Transect 156, where we're seeing a more contemporary trend where it's kind of historically been pretty stable. Now even that southern component of the shoreline is starting to face some pretty significant erosion rates, right? So we learned a little bit about the history of the system. And then what we want to do is start looking at what was happening with currents, hydrodynamics within the system. To do that, we use this model called EFDC, Environmental Fluid Dynamics Code. We have tons of different models. For each project, we go through an evaluation to select the best model for the project. For this one, why did we pick this? Well, there were a lot of reasons, primarily because we feel like it could be extended for other uses for the town into the future. So it's currently in a two-dimensional, but can be extended to three-dimensional. We can add salinity temperature, we can do water quality, sediment transport. We can look at effects of restoration projects to marshes. We can evaluate, even for this one, dredging projects. So how you might want to change your dredging, what would that do to the system? This is the model grid here. It's very high resolution. It goes down to about 5 meters, meaning every 5 meters we have, or more, we have data on what the current field's doing, how water's moving, what the water levels are. Next slide. Here you can kind of see a zoom in on that and how high resolution it really is throughout the system. You'll notice we go right over the barrier beach because we're evaluating storm events that in sea level rise conditions that in the future might go right over the beach, right, the water. So we want to see what happens there in those cases. Here's what the basically the elevational information looks like. And, you know, it gets a little washed out in green here. Now, we can zoom in and really see what the differences are. But you can get the general idea of the channels, the marsh system, the barrier beach, the higher points, Clark's Island, and so on, that exist in the system. We calibrated that model to, remember, going back to those data that we collected, the tide, we want to make sure the model was simulating that correctly. So we looked at all three locations, Upper Marsh, Harbor Master, Clark's Island of the data. And we did some error statistics with relative errors. We're getting pretty small errors, 0.02 feet, right? So we're under an inch. We're getting that right, okay? And this just is a way that we quantify the observed data versus the model data. You want it to lie right on this blue line the whole way. We're very reasonable on that. I mean, we get off a little bit at the low tide, primarily because the marsh is hard to get right. The marshes, we're really not concerned about. We're really focused on the beach right now, so we're not overly concerned that we've got that maybe a little bit off. But again, it's within inches. I'm going to do this part. I don't really trust Andre with models. So this is kind of what it looks like dynamically then, when we start to look at the tides going up and down. These arrows indicate water velocity. It's hard to see the scale here, but so we know what the speed of the water is doing in and out. You can see how it's wetting and drying. So there's mud flats at those spring lows, right? You can actually see some of that dry out in certain areas. You can see the major channels. Watch the marsh up here and how that wets and dries is a function of time, okay? Some unique circulation patterns start to develop offshore. Obviously, you can see how the current, strongest currents are obviously right in here through the main throat of the channel that you're coming in and out. But this is a tool we can start to use to evaluate what's going on for this project, you know, through here. But there's other purposes for it in the future as well. Next slide. Yeah, I really don't trust you. I love Andre. So here, just to zoom in, again, that area, right, where the Cobble Burn project is, where we put the tilt current meter, we're really focused on what's happening there with some of the currents. Again, this is a zoom in, kind of looking at that area a little bit closer, again, as the tides go up and down in the model. Okay. Go down one more. So what I did just real quickly to start to look at what was happening on the back side of the barrier was extracted kind of the maximum velocities that existed during a normal tidal situation along the beach. And this blue zone I really focused on because you'll notice the jump in the current speed there, right? Well, sure enough, that's that navigational channel that rides right up against the shoreline there, and we've more than doubled the current speed at that location. So it's not surprising that during a high tide or certainly a storm event, you're going to get some erosive properties along there that exist and start to scour that location and cause some issues along that stretch. But, yeah, go ahead. Okay, so that was kind of the currents. We now need to couple that with waves. Since currents aren't the only answer, right? There's also waves going out there. I threw that equation up there just to scare people. Did it work? Okay, good. So scare people a little bit. This is basically, you don't have to know about that. Really, all you need to know is that waves come from offshore, and they do things, right? They shoal, they break, they wrap around things, right? Surfers love it when we really get into this stuff. Essentially, this model captures a lot of that. They do different things. Why is that important? Because if I just took the waves out here and said, okay, I know what the waves do out here, so this is how sand must be moving. No, because the waves do a lot because of what's going on under the water when they can go from here to here, right? And we need to understand that. Next slide. So, this is just a zoom in of what it looks like. You can see the big shoal off of High Pines. That's a big important feature that exists with the bathymetry. Okay. Wave information, go down a couple. All right, so there, remember, is our gauge we put in. One more. These are the two additional data sources we're using when we start to look at waves. Okay, so we want to quantify, do the waves out here, can we replicate waves coming from here to here? If we can, great. Then we can start to look at what's happening over kind of like an average annual condition, what's happening with storms. Next slide. So we did that. We validated the model. And then we basically generate all these different cases looking at how waves impact the beach and how different storms impact the beach. Next slide. Okay, this is the scary part. It's coming back. This is like a big storm now. No, these are just average annual conditions. Arrows indicate directions of waves. The colors indicate wave heights. Reds are higher. Okay, so this isn't a storm event. This is just normally what happens out there. Waves don't, you know, they come from different directions, right? Sometimes they come from some directions more frequently than others, but we're looking at the whole range, right? We want to get a good picture of what happens an average year out on the beach. Why? We need to want to know how the sand moves on an average year, okay? Of course, the most interesting thing you see is the shoal that exists off of High Pines and how that really transforms the waves. They break, they get that red color means the waves are shoaling up and breaking on that or heightening over that. And then they wrap around and they do some really interesting things as they approach the shoreline in that area. So we're quantifying that. Next slide. It'll come back. All right. We also looked at storms. This is a 50-year storm event. And again, you can see the influence on the waves of the shoal and throughout the entire system. One thing I would say that I noticed relatively quickly, which is a little different than a lot of beaches in Massachusetts, is that the waves generally align themselves, no matter what direction they're coming from, pretty sure parallel, once they, with the exception of this area, when they get to the beach. That generally means that the beach has kind of established its stability, right? It's established where it kind of wants to live, how it wants to orient itself. So that orientation, which is kind of unique, right, if you think about it, there's a lot of geology there, but it also has been shaped in the past so that that's the position it's comfortable in, okay? That doesn't mean storms don't disrupt it, but under normal conditions, that's kind of how it wants to live. Okay, next slide. Remember we looked at currents along the back side. I also just kind of extracted what the wave heights do along the front side. I'll just point out one interesting thing here with this increase in wave energy right there. So you can see how the distribution of wave energy changes along a coastline. Right? That's important, right? There's areas where there's more higher energy that generally is going to exist. There's areas where there's lower energy. That starts to indicate areas that are more prone to erosion or more prone to maybe deposition or stability or accretion. That high area right there exists kind of between your first and second crossovers, which I generally believe is primarily, correct me if I'm wrong, but I think it's kind of an erosive problem area.
Yeah, it is.
Right? Right. So that's that, right? So you're generally on an average annual condition, you know, not every day, but on average, when the waves come in, you're going to get more wave energy in that area, and that's why you're battling erosion in that location. Next slide. Okay, is everybody hanging in there okay? It's a lot of technical stuff, but sediment transport. Okay, so we understand the currents, we understand the waves, hopefully a little bit better. Now we're going to get into sediment transport. What we do, which is a little different than most coastal engineering companies, is we really do a physics-based representation of sand movement. So there's a lot of empirical calculations of how sand moves. We actually calculate the currents and how they're picking up the sand and moving it. Okay? And so there's a lot of fancy words up there, but essentially what I want you to understand is that when waves come in, they generate these currents. Okay? It's those currents that are wave generated that are really moving the sand. So if you have waves coming in this direction, you create this up and down on the beach, but you also create this longshore current that exists out there. Okay? A lot of people understand crossshore current, right? Oh, riptides, it's going to pull us off. But there's a longshore current that generally exists out there that's moving sand along the beach. Next slide. We're still refining this a little bit. This is the last piece of what we have to do. This is the longshore movement of sand. And if it's negative, which it is here, on an average annual basis, that means sand is generally moving from north to south. Okay, so on an average basis, you basically have, if you follow this blue line, sand moving down to the south from the north. Okay, that's consistent with what I would normally, what we would expect given the elongation of that barrier down in that direction. During a storm, the magnitude of that sediment transport goes up drastically. So you get a lot more sand moving in that case. We're still, those historical shoreline change rates and the wave, we're still tying those together to get up that to the final result, but I wanted to show you at least where we were. So generally, you basically have sand moving, on average again, north to south. Now you do have conditions that may move it to the south on occasion, to the north on occasion if you have the right wave direction, but if you average up what happens over the whole year, this is what the case is. So we look at waves, we look at currents, we look at sediment transport. We also are kind of interested in climate change, sea level rise. I'll show you some more of those results later, but those are all, we put those all in the wave model and the current model too. But we also just kind of took a quick look at the natural resources. This is part of another project actually that Duxbury is benefiting of. This is CZM's work that we're doing, looking at how natural resources are changing due to the changing climate sea level rise. So this is present day kind of existing conditions of these mapped resources. You have irregularly fronted marsh, which is the marsh system up here. You have Barrier Beach and some of the other areas. If you go down, you can kind of see what happens when we jump to 2030 with sea level rise and then 2070. You're losing a lot of the marsh system. It's transitioning. This beach is eroding more. So we're using some of this information to help kind of inform us what we should be expecting for natural resources. Okay, so kind of the summary of what we learned from existing conditions, and this is just a few of those. You know, seaward side, not surprisingly, is all eroding. And you know what? The erosion rates are increasing, except where? At the reservation parking lot, because somebody's doing a pretty good job with dune management, resiliency, right? The backside of the Barrier Beach has historically been pretty neutral, but now, contemporarily, that's starting to increase erosion too. primarily that has to do with that rising sea level, right? Your high tides are a little bit higher. The current energy is getting up on that backside. You're losing a little bit of marsh on the backside of high pine. So there's things that are happening there. Generally, the hydrating model is well calibrated. I think you can use that for a number of other purposes besides what we're just doing today. So that's good. That we looked at the increased tidal velocity along the backside of the barrier. That's related to increased erosion. On the seaward side, we have these hot spots of wave energy that have developed some erosion, especially during storm events. We have the north to south sediment transport and overwash processes happening on the beach. And I didn't even get into this, but we have these areas of accretion and deposition due to the changing sediment rate along the shoreline. All right, so that was a real kind of whirlwind summary of kind of what's going on out there. Now I'm going to get into some of the stuff that we're working on next. Okay, so we're not done with this. This is kind of a sneak preview, right, of the next movie that's coming out. And this is stuff done by the Beach Reservation Committee to help me identify areas that were problematic. So Jim and crew put this together, and they've identified 9 locations from the pavilion to the salt marsh on the backside of High Pines to the third crossover of areas that we want to focus in. And these are those smaller, attainable projects to me that you can actually make progress on. Of course, we're looking at the resilience of the entire Barrier Beach system as well, but let's take a look at a few of these real quick. What can we do? So this grant is really focused on green resiliency adaptations, okay? That doesn't mean I'm solely going to look at green resiliency adaptations, but what we really want to focus on are there some adaptations that we can start to implement in Duxbury Beach that will help build resiliency. So those typically fall in the realm of beach nourishment, dune restorations, berm construction, vegetation, which you guys are doing a lot of already, you know, reefs offshore, some bioengineering. You've already done cobble berms out there, living shorelines, and kind of the list goes on, right? This is a beach nourishment in Virginia Beach there. Some bioengineering I'll get into in a little bit. Next slide. So let's just take a couple examples. I'm not going to go through all 9 sites tonight, but we're starting to, this is what we're working on right now, is taking all that coastal processes information, taking the site-specific locations, generating some ideas with the Duxbury Beach Reservation Committee to come up with some thoughts and processes. If you have input on this, great. So this is Plum Hills. We've got some overwash on the backside of the marsh. We have erosion on the frontal side of the dunes. Next slide. This is what kind of happens out there normally today. So we look at the longshore sediment transport. Another thing that we're looking at is the crossshore movement of sand. So this is just the existing beach profile here at that location. I don't show the marshes on the backside. This is the water surface elevation. So this is the tide going up and down. And then this indicates the waves that exist in the height here going to the beach. So this is normal day-to-day conditions. So you can see a little bit of change. The black line is what the survey indicated. The dashed line is the kind of what was there when we started the simulation. Just minor changes. And most of this change is just due to the fact that the profile data isn't probably accurate of what's out there. Next slide. But if you look at what happens for a 50-year storm event, right, now those lines are going a little bit crazier, right? You have storm surge, you have bigger wave height, and now you can see what's happening to the beach and the erosion. So if you've got a 50-year event, pretty big event, you're going to see how that beach erodes, okay? So we're looking at what's happening for existing conditions, but we can also start to look at if we implemented various solutions and then run that simulation at what, how that protection might work. Next slide. That's the end of the simulation. So this is what, during a 50-year storm event, what you might be left with after that storm happened, okay? All right, so at this location, you know, maybe one of the things we can think about is bioengineering, right? So these are biodegradable envelopes that you can put in that kind of strengthen the core of a dune. At that particular Plum Island site, it might make a lot of sense to bolster some of the dunes on the front side where you're losing that frontal dune, but maybe we could consider bolstering them a little bit with some biodegradable systems and then planting them. Next slide. First and second crossover, big erosion problem, big, this is where waves, right, are happening more frequently. So would I propose a biodegradable solution here? No, because the waves are going to rip it apart, right? So here we have, you know, due to eroding and narrowing in this particular location. Next slide. I want to show you what happens here during a 50-year storm. It's not as nice as at Plum Hills. So we'll watch this. So this, think of this as a pretty big nor'easter. You know, somewhere blizzard at 1978 level, maybe a little bit less. But again, you can see what's happening to the dune. You can see on the backside, right, so we just had an overwash of the dune system. All that sand got carried back.
We've seen that.
Yeah, you've seen it? Well, yeah, and so now it's flattened out. So this sand got carried back onto the backside. This is one of the most vulnerable sections, right? Why the waves are higher, it's pretty narrow, it's not that resilient, right? So this is something that would happen with a 50-year event. Next slide. This is, I mentioned we're also looking at sea level rise. So this is a 10-year event 50 years from now, right? So if we're in 2065 and we haven't done anything to the beach yet, and we had a pretty minor storm, right? Like one chance, 10% chance event. Yeah, there it goes again. So again, just thinking about what we're really faced with in the future. Next slide. We're using all these tools to really start. So here, you know, maybe it's a beach and dune restoration project. This is an example of something. We're working on the visualization. This is obviously isn't Duxbury. This is Sandwich, Massachusetts, hit down. This, you know, is what we're working on out there. Beach, get that beach out in front of it, okay? I can't stress enough, based on actual on-the-ground projects, that these are systems, okay? Dunes by themselves, without, if you don't have a beach out in front, if you go back a little bit, Andre, at high tide, you can see, you basically have dune here, right? And these people put this in, but you have no beach, okay? If you just put a dune in with no beach, it's not going to work. So it's a system. You got to have that energy dissipation out front. So this is a project. There's a long story behind this project, which I'm not going to get into now, but beach and dune restoration are key. Next slide. All right, one more example. Kind of looking at the backside. High Pines. This is the area of the Western Bay, just of High Pines region. A lot of marsh loss going. Remember that area with a big spike? That's here. Right? You're losing a lot of marsh on there. Why is that important? Well, marshes really do provide a lot of resiliency. So go down. So, you know, some of the thoughts we have here are actually like, let's try a pilot living shoreline application. Right? So a living shoreline creates some, it doesn't have to be this dramatic with the rocks. This is just an example of one. But a sill that you then basically put a marsh behind it, you fill that in, give it some stability, let the marsh grow. I'm surprised, I've been to a lot of, we're doing a lot of marsh restoration projects where marshes really do a pretty good job of keeping up with sea level rise on their own. They capture sediment, you know, from overwash with that vegetation in there. So maybe some kind of living shoreline project on the backside, that would be a good pilot site to see how these things kind of work in Massachusetts on the backside of barriers. Next slide. Thin layer deposition is another project. This is a project we're working on in Rhode Island where we're actually spreading sediment to increase the elevation of areas, okay? So again, building that marsh up. And there's an example from Virginia and Rhode Island. This is Ninigrit Pond that we're working on here. I do have one more example. So, and then everybody knows about, this is that channel on the backside. Again, we pretty much know that this channel is causing that erosion on the backside. Again, this is a fairly weak spot of the barrier. It's narrow, right? This is where that cobble berm went in, and maybe that's good enough for now. But one of the things I think we're considering is, hey, should we really relocate this? Right? Should we dredge in a different location, get it away from the barrier beach, which is we need for resiliency, and think about a different navigational channel? So that's something the hydrodynamic model can start to look at and evaluate. Next slide. So overall, you know, on the harbor side, some of the ideas that I think we're talking about is these bioengineered solutions, living shorelines at very erosive areas, you know, channel relocation, dredging, moving that channel somewhere else, using that material for marsh restoration and resiliency, right? So if I dredge a channel somewhere else, I have to fill the old one in, but maybe it's going to be a longer extent with more sediment. Maybe we can co-benefit that with a marsh restoration. On the seaward side, we're really talking about expanded. I mean, there's been a lot of good work already been going on with some of the dune work and so on and so forth, but should we expand that, enhance it? Dune restoration, beach restoration, you know, overfilling the beach at these hotspot locations, like between that, you know, first and second crossover. Maybe there's some restoration project with enhanced or more resilient dune cores. You know, if we're going to go away from the green, Jason, it's okay to go away from green a little bit, right? And so maybe talking about some low-profile notched groins and high erosion areas and to decelerate the transport along the shoreline, try to reduce that. And maybe we can think of some innovative ways to start tackling that a little bit. This is lower probability. But. All right, so I just want to end this on, you know, just going back to the kind of the scope of services here. So task one, we're done. Task two, three, four, done. We're kind of in the midst of this task five, six, and then feeding it back into the models. So that's just kind of where we are right now. I think we're making really good progress here overall. So that's a quick summary. Next slide. So that's all I have. This is an hour.
Yeah, but we're going to let some questions if anybody has questions. And I've got a mic.
And Maggie, are you going to be the microphone distributor?
Well, we've got two. We've got two.
Here.
I don't really need a microphone, I don't think. We want to put the microphone. Okay. Well, my big question is, I've talked to people about the projects that we face, and the common question that I get is, you can't fight Mother Nature. Well, Kurt, can we fight Mother Nature?
That's a good question. So, I'll answer that in kind of a unique way. So, yes and no. And I know that might not be the answer you want to hear, but over the long term, no. You're not going to win against Mother Nature. If the projections of sea level rise go the rate that they're going to go, there's going to be a point in time, you know, 70 to 100 years out, where you're not going to win. And it's going to be a tough battle, right? That doesn't mean that this won't exist, but it means that, you know, during storms, it's going to take a pretty bad beat. In the midterm, though, I think there is a fair number of things you can do to increase resiliency, bolster that, and create something that has a better chance, okay? Here's the catch to that. Just because the projected sea level rise rates show, you know, 3 to 4 feet by 2100, that doesn't mean that's what's actually gonna happen, right? That's scientists' best guess, and things are, you know, trending in that direction, but we can, you know, we don't know for sure, right? So there's time to watch that. There's time to build the resiliency. And then if that slows down or changes direction, you know, it still makes sense to start to do some things here that help build that resiliency, because it is such a protected feature for the rest of the town. So does that help answer that a little bit and put it in some?
So you gave me hope for my lifetime.
Yeah. So, the idea is, like, we're planning for our lifetime in the future too, and it's a wait and see approach to see if the projected rates really go that high. And so that's where I would sit on that.
Who else has a question?
Long Beach in Plymouth has had a lot of overwashes over history, and the Army Corps of Engineers has come in with congressional funding a number of times historically, and fixed Long Beach because the town of Plymouth was threatened. So if you're projecting that Duxbury Beach might be opened, could the Army Corps of Engineers potentially come in as a solution to a threat to Duxbury and help with the beach?
It's always a possibility, yes. I mean, Long Beach and Plymouth is certainly more threatened currently than Duxbury is. But there are federal grants and federal processes available that may turn that direction in the future. So.
This is a point of information, and we are currently appealing a FEMA decision to deny. We're currently appealing a FEMA decision that denied an application the beach reservation had for the spring storm in 2013, of which we sustained $1 million worth of damage to put it back into the original condition. So we are working as best we can. We hoped to prevail at that, but we haven't had good luck so far. They've actually denied us. We've gone back. We're actually asking for congressional help right now to have them reconsider what they've already done. So it's something that we're looking at, which we're not giving up on it, but if we fail in this event and regulations don't change, we may be on our own.
And just to add on that, FEMA is a different federal organization than the Army Corps, so there are some different avenues to pursue.
And part B of that, I hate to think of this, but what if the beach were breached? What would happen to the town?
Well, I mean, I think we're a long ways off. I mean, I think a breach could occur, but it's repairable, right? So during that particular storm event, I don't think the town would actually experience much under that first kind of breach situation, but if left open and it continues and the barrier becomes less and less a feature, then you're going to definitely experience increased flooding, increased wave energy due to the lack of that barrier beach system out there. So.
And the third part is, how is this comparable to Monomoy, Chatham, that opening, and that whole dynamic that happened over the last 20 years?
Yeah, I mean, that's a much more dynamic system, bigger tidal prism, very strong sediment transport there, much greater sediment transport supply. It's not really comparable to this location. Pleasant Bay is a huge barrier beach. That's an ongoing cycle that's happened for centuries and centuries. That breach was going to happen. Everybody knew it was going to happen. Monomoy Island was the spit, formerly. It just keeps migrating down, breaching back up. That inlet will then migrate to the south. It will breach again. It's just an ongoing cycle that happens at that particular location because of the strong sediment supply, big waves. Not similar to this. So this is a barrier beach connecting headland locations that exist. You could get a breach. I don't think the inlet would stay open here because you have a very well-established large opening into Duxbury Harbor that has enough water moving in and out that this would close once it breaches again. I think what you really have to worry about is long-term thinning of the beach, flattening of the beach, and then sea level rise going over top. So.
Another question.
Yeah, Fernando Guitart. Sean, just building on your comment just there about the beach and not being able to get the funding it needs to kind of maintain itself, there seems to be, again, from that, there's a issue with the beach long term getting enough dependable sources of funding to maintain itself. So is there any thought of changing that dynamic? Here you have a model that will project sea level rise or make a forecast. It'll project damage that might occur, and then you can go ahead, based on that, project your expenses required to maintain resiliency of the beach. All right, so that gives you an idea of what money you need to raise or need to fund. So where can you get alternative sources for that funding? Relying on the town or relying on people paying? Are you guys been thinking about a different model to ensure that you can guarantee that funding to maintain the beach resiliency rather than kind of living from donations, living from whatever sources of income you have right now? Any thought to that?
A lot of exercise here. Sure. Since 91, we've been in maintenance mode. In 91, the Army Corps of Engineers did design a artificial dune for us that was supposed to be designed to withstand a 5-year storm event. It cost upwards of $3 million, I think, something like that. It got washed out in 92. It was rebuilt by the Army Corps of Engineers with FEMA funding. Part of this is why we're keeping pushing FEMA to keep doing this. But, and we've been very lucky in the meantime, but we've actually maintained what we call our artificial beach. In other words, once we had that elevation 16, which is the height that the Army Corps designed it to, we've been filling every time we have an event. Last year we had an event that washed through at Plum Hills, a significant, we paid about $30,000 this spring to plug that hole, replant that hole, patch it all back in, back to where it is. So we've really been on, if you think about it in your house, we've been on repair mode and maintain mode to try to keep the beach at the elevation it is. We're not doing anything about elevation, sea level rise, until we did our first project, which was elevate the roadway from the north end to the east end of the Powder Point Bridge south. We elevated that entire road 18 inches. We're doing the same thing now, as Andre talked about, at the pavilion end. But we're going to, I can see that we're going to need significant more resources over coming years. Maybe not in my immediate lifetime, but it's certainly going to be my kids and future kids of people that are here. The only way we're going to maintain the beach is to look for additional funding, which is why we're fighting so hard right now with FEMA.
I would just like to add a PS to Sean's comments. We did start about 10 years ago to build an endowment for the beach reservation, and we have that up around $4 million. And that's come with a lot of hard fundraising work. And the idea of having this endowment, we call it a storm damage fund, is if we get that breach or a severe washover, we can't wait for the town or somebody to say, well, come see us next month after we evaluate your problem. We have to be out there the very next day. And that's why we have this storm damage fund. And so I don't want to take away from Kirk's presentation. Are there any more questions that would relate to Kirk? All right. Somebody over there, can you?
With regard to the marsh, I noticed there were some man-made ditches in that marsh. Do those ditches weaken the marsh? And if so, would it make any sense to block off flow into those ditches and allow them to fill up with sediment?
Yeah, those ditches are traditionally done by mosquito control. So they'll go in there and dig channels to basically help drainage. They don't really have a negative impact on the resiliency of the marsh system. In fact, in some cases they improve it because they're delivering water and getting water off areas that need that exchange to help the marsh species grow. So I generally would think the channels are a good idea. Now, if you have a marsh that's really eroding a lot, there might be cases where you might want to look at where the channels are situated, but generally speaking, those are an okay place.
Next.
In terms of remediation efforts elsewhere, like down in the Jersey coast, for instance, I understand that in a lot of areas they've actually pumped sand from offshore onto shore. Is that something that would be possible here?
Yeah, good question. So I'll start by saying the state of Massachusetts is behind in that process compared to other states, New Jersey, Florida, places like that, where they have it a little bit more down to a science. They have offshore barrel locations they can go and that are permitted and certified to then pump sand on the beaches. New Jersey has that for a lot of their stretch, New York as well. It is a possibility that I think we're pursuing as a state a little bit more. So CZM certainly supports that. I know Woodsville Group supports that a lot. That project I showed you in Sandwich is being developed partially using an offshore borrow site, from a nearshore borrow site in that case, to basically take sand from that offshore location and put it on the beach. So we're hopefully making strides in that direction. The tough part of that is fisheries, right? So fisheries does not like to mess with the offshore bottom, right? Because it's habitat. So it's really an identification of where the best locations to extract sediment are. The state, it has a program now where they've identified zones where we can start to look that should allow for extraction of sediment. I think there's a pilot study or two that we're going to see. Sandwich is going to be one of them. Duxbury should jump on board to be another one of those, because fisheries and the other regulatory agencies are going to want to see what happens when you start taking significant amounts of material off the bottom of the ocean and putting it on a beach. I'm sure Jason has a lot to say about this too, but I definitely think Duxbury should be pursuing that avenue as a pilot project type approach for the state.
Next.
Red Fawcett. There seems to be a constant migration of sand in a southerly direction along the beach. You said there was a beach current that went south, I think. What's the effect, what would the effect be of having vertical breakwaters out to the sea away, like they have on many beaches, I've seen them. Would that stop this southerly migration of sand, which is probably winding up over on Browns Bank and Plymouth Beach?
Yeah, so you're, just so I understand and clear what you're saying, when you say vertical, you mean kind of perpendicular to the shoreline, right?
Yeah.
Heading offshore. Yeah, so that, one of the alternatives that we started talking about are these groins. That's what those are called. So they're groins that go offshore. Yes, they do stop and reduce the movement of sand, but there's also a detriment to them. You have to be very, very careful, because when you stop the movement of sand, you're robbing that from the downdrift shoreline because it can't get there. So they're not the most ideal setting in a lot of places because they disrupt that natural movement of sediment. I think we are looking at kind of these notch type systems that allow more sediment, you know, kind of slowing it down and not completely stopping it. It's something I think we might want to look at here a little bit. I don't think it's a leading candidate because of some of the negative impacts that occur. So, and it's not something that's easy to get permitted and approved in the state. So,
you mentioned building up on the inside of the beach, the marshes, by putting some manner of barrier and then filling behind it, or otherwise encouraging the marsh to grow. I may be way off on my idea of the numbers, but my impression is that about every 10 years we dredge something on the order of 200,000 cubic yards of mud out of the channel, and it goes right out into the middle of Cape Cod Bay for many reasons, I understand, including contamination. But now, since that spoil is so recent, is that a place to look for material to build up the dune on the inside?
Not so much the dune, but for marshes, yes.
Marshes. Yeah. Yeah.
So certainly you got to be careful with the contamination aspect, right? So that has to go through that evaluation process. But yeah, that type of material is exactly what you want to do to start doing those thin layer deposition or living shoreline type solutions. Sometimes it, you know, it depends on the distribution of the grain size of the material that has to be evaluated. But yeah, I generally would support, you know, not taking material and dumping it somewhere offshore, because you're taking it out of the system. Now, if it's contaminated, it's another situation. But if you can beneficially reuse that in some manner through a marsh restoration or living shoreline, it might cost a little bit more, but I think it's worth it.
I'll just add. Just add to that, the material that was dredged here was not contaminated, and in fact it had to pass biological testing in order to be able to go to the Wellfleet site, so it's generally clean.
So use it.
I agree with Ned on that, and if we could get a project going where every year we take 15,000 cubic yards and put it in there with multiple, you know, a small project every year, put it in and build in small amounts, you're not going to have the pollution problem because you've got fresh spoils, basically. It's only been sitting there for a shorter period of time. So I think viable way to go with that stuff.
Two quick questions. One, is there an interaction between the road and the dune so that the road is like an essential part of it because it has a very hardening and makes the core of the dune perhaps more solid? Did you look at anything or have you thought about the interaction between the dune and the road? Then the other question is, we're part of a regional system and all that movement, and if you go down from the Cape Cod Canal and you go north from the canal, you have all kinds of different conditions. And I don't know whether there's any interaction or any concerted effort to look at this as a regional issue as well as obviously a Duxbury issue.
Sure. Thank you. So in terms of the first question, in the road, that's something we're just getting into with those cross-shore models. So the road does provide some resiliency to the middle of Barrier Beach. It's not, you know, it's not at an elevation right now where it's going to stop overwash and overtopping of the road. And under certain situations, the road can be a little bit of a detriment if you start to erode or scarp at the edge and the road kind of causes some reflective energy to work on the beach. But generally, it is kind of, you know, helps the resiliency overall of that system.
It's not a huge player
in the mix. I think the mic's going in and out. But system-wise, there's littoral cells that exist up and down the coast. You know, the Duxbury Plymouth area is kind of one of them. As you start to go further down and go to the canal, you know, there's cells. There is regional thinking that happens in this whole thing. But, you know, the entrance to Duxbury Harbor is a pretty good separator for a cell. And so we're really focused on Duxbury Beach right now.
How about one more?
Thank you. We all love spending time on the beach. And with our various activities on the beach, is there any connection between human activity on the beach, and does it have any effect, or does it have any effect on erosion?
Yeah, good question.
Driving.
So driving on the beach is, and how you drive on the beach is critically related to erosion in areas. Staying out of the dunes, especially vegetated areas, really important. You know, there's a lot of, like that sandwich site I was showing you, they have a lot of problems with people getting into the dunes and eroding in just by walking up and down them and messing with the grass. So if you see a planted, vegetated dune, definitely try to stay out of it. It's okay to be down on the beach, so those things. And then, of course, if you ask, you know, bird people, they'll say, yeah, there's a huge relationship between humans and the birds. But for erosion, stay out of the dunes, and then driving. Right, those are the two things I would say are the biggest influences.
So driving on the beach is somewhat detrimental to the beach. Is that what
it is? Yeah. I mean, you know, obviously.
I just want to add to that. We are extremely regulated. You cannot drive on our beach. We have a designated pathway in a section of the beach for recreational vehicles. You cannot go off of that. You can't drive on the dunes. You all know about the bird monitors and the restrictions we have there. I don't think, and we have even had, the reservation has had studies done about the small amount of driving down the corridors on the front side, and our studies have consistently shown no damage. So I think we can ease off on that concern. I don't want to keep Kirk here too long. He's been very good with the presentation, and I think he deserves a big round of applause. Thank you, Kirk, and he's with us, and the study's going to be finished in June. And I'm just going to ask for your patience for just two more minutes as I ask another one of our trustees, Ken Johnston, just to come up and give you one small little plug for us.
Thanks, Maggie. You can probably guess what I'm going to say. We need, this is a very, very big project to keep this beach alive and growing. We need help. We need your financial help. And we started last year, and we were able to raise a substantial amount of money, which has helped us to rebuild that back road. But there's much more to be done, and we'll be coming to talk to people this year, and I hope that you'll receive us gladly and profitably. Thank you very much.
Thank you, all of you, for coming and listening. We want to spread the word about the good work the reservation has done, and we need your support, but we're going to keep at it. We have for a long time, and we're going to keep at it. Thank you for coming tonight.